Welcome to the West End Church of Christ. We are conveniently located at 44th and Broadway. Our address is 4401 West Broadway. Our regular hours of service are 10 a.m. we have our morning Bible study, 11 a.m. we have our morning worship, at 5 p.m. we have our Sunday evening worship. Also, on Wednesdays, we have midweek Bible study service at 7 p.m. The West End Church of Christ also presents a call-in Bible talk show called More Bible Talk. More Bible Talk is presented on WLLV, that is 1240 on the AM dial. More Bible Talk is presented on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday from 2 to 2:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. The call-in show allows people to call in and their Bible questions are answered in a Bible manner. The West End Church of Christ also has a website. The website is www.westendcoc.com. Feel free to use this website as you can retrieve sermons that are presented from the pulpit. We offer it in video format as well as in audio format and streaming data.
And our scripture reading for this morning comes from the third book of John. The third book of John. We'll be reading verses 1 through 4. Third book of John, verses 1, 2, 3, and 4. And it reads, "The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that in all respects you may prosper and be in good health, just as your soul prospers. For I was very glad when brethren came and testified to your truth. That is, how you are walking in truth. I have no greater joy than this, to hear of my children walking in truth." I've just read 3rd book of John, verses 1 through 4.
Amen.
If you would, let us turn our song books to page 376. Page 376.
Somewhere the sun is shining, somewhere the songbirds wail, hush in thy sand refining, God lives and all is well. Somewhere, beautiful Isle of somewhere, land of the truth, where we live anew. Beautiful Isle of somewhere. Somewhere the day is longer, somewhere the task is done, somewhere the heart people out of somewhere, land of the true, where we live anew. Beautiful out of somewhere, somewhere the load is lifted, loads by an open grave, somewhere the clouds are rifted, somewhere the angels wait, somewhere beautiful, beautiful out, beautiful out of somewhere, land of the true, where we live anew. Beautiful out of somewhere.
Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we first want to say thank you for allowing us to wake up again this morning, Father God, to come to your house of worship, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Amen. We thank you for your blessed Son, Jesus Christ, who came to this earth, hung, bled, and died for our sins. And we thank you, Father God, for that sacrifice. Father God, we pray for our elders, who leads us and guides us in spiritual matters. We pray for our sick, our shut-in. We pray for each and every individual that's in our congregation. We pray for the lost, Father God, the ones who are out there in the streets and hungry and homeless. We pray and we know that with your abilities, you will see that they will be all right. Father God, we thank you so much for all the blessings that you bestow upon us, the things we take for granted, the food we eat, the clothing we wear, the shelter over our heads. We go about it meaningless because we take everything for granted. But we thank you for the blessings that you give us. We thank you, Father God, for being our Father and our God. And we thank you so much for Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's turn our songbooks to page 322 as we make preparation for the Lord's Supper. 322.
On a hill far away, for a world
And now we come to the part of this service where we observe the Lord's Supper and partake of the bread and the fruit of the vine, and to bear remembrance of something that was done for us. So let us bow and give thanks for the bread. Our Father who art in heaven, I thank we are, Father, for your love and mercy, for your sending your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins.
Yeah.
We pray, Father, that we might be in remembrance and have the right mind as we partake of this bread, knowing that it was his body that he gave up for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And now we are, it's time to remember the fruit of the vine, which represents Christ's blood that was shed for us. The Bible tells us without the remission of sins, without the shedding of blood, there would be no remission of sins. So let's bow and give thanks for the fruit of the vine. Our Father who art in heaven, we thank you, Father, for this gathering. Thanking you, Heavenly Father, to allow us this time to gather ourselves together to be remembrance of the sacrifice that was made for us and the love that was shown for us, Father. We pray that as we partake of this fruit of the vine, which represents our Son's shed blood, that we remember and be encouraged that it was done for us and that we might continue to fight the good fight of faith. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you would, you can mark your songbooks to page 640. 640 will be the song of invitation immediately after the lesson. Now, if you would, let us turn to page 498. 498. And if it is comfortable for you, please stand.
Roll out the bloodline across the dark way. There is a brother whom someone should say. Somebody's brother, oh, who then will dare to throw out the bloodline his fair oath to share? Throw out the lifeline, throw out the lifeline. Someone is drifting away. Throw out the lifeline, throw out the lifeline. Someone is sinking today. Throw out the lifeline with hand quick and strong. Why do you tarry? Why linger so long? See, he is sinking, oh, haste unto day, and out with the lifeboat, oh, wade it away. Roll out the lifeline, roll out the lifeline, someone is drifting away.
Thanks
for what he has done for each one of us. It is always, always a good thing to be able to wait and to hear the sound of the birds chirping, the dogs barking, and people going about their busy way. We need to understand, though, within having that pleasure, that we need to stop and give God thanks. Yeah. For it is because of Him that we were able to wake on this morning and to be able to move about the activity of our limbs, knowing that this is the Lord's day. And that as we gather our thoughts, we get prepared for this day, that we give back some time to Him, worship Him in spirit and in truth. This morning, I would like to talk to you for a little while about recognizing that which is true. Recognizing that which is true. There are a lot of people on this morning that are worshiping our God, worshiping the living God. Now, all the worship that is being offered to Him on this morning is not acceptable. Now, I know that is hard to think about, that if a person says that they're worshiping God, then people just assume that God is accepting that. There may be some that are sitting here right now that are worshiping God, but is God accepting that worship? Recognizing that which is true. In the book of John, chapter 17, John chapter 17, and we'll go back to 3 John in just a moment. John 17, as our Lord and our Savior prays to the Father. This is a good example here that the two are separate. The two are two different beings, shall I say, because when we start looking through John chapter 17, you'll find that they are one, and that one is one in purpose, one accord, doing what the other would do, the things that are right. Jesus, as he prays to the Father, he says in verse 14, I have given them your word, and the word has in the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is sanctify them, set them apart. How? Look at it. Look what it says. In the truth. In the truth. See, from the very beginning, man heard what was true. Now, whether he believed it or not is one thing. But he heard what was true because the truth was spoken by God. That is what we need to recognize today. We start talking about recognizing that which is true. Is it from God? If our worship according to the pattern, is our worship according to our pattern, are we keeping ourselves unspotted from the world? in order to be the people that God desires for us to be. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. Go back now to the book of 3 John. 3 John, that scripture that was read by Brother DeMel, and I appreciate him for reading that. And as we look at it once again, understanding the words in which John wrote here and the themes in which he was saying to the person that he was saying them. 3 John verse 1, the elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Now let's stop there again. Truth. This word truth is something that we need to deal with. Exactly what is truth? Well, we've already established what his word. Your word is truth. What the truth that we are talking about, the truth that we want to deal with, is an absolute truth. Do you understand what an absolute truth is? It is a truth, no matter where you go, no matter what you do, it is always going to be truth. You can't change it, no matter how hard you try. You cannot change what is true. If God said it, we need to believe it as being true. So here, John is saying, whom I love in truth. Not because of what you do, but because of who I am, because of the great I am. I love you in truth. But you know, as you look at this and see the things that John is saying in reference to Gaius here, that Gaius understood what truth was. He understood what it meant to be loved in truth because he did that which was true. He says, beloved, I pray that in all, that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. For I rejoiced greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, as indeed you are walking in truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Someone comes to you and they say, you know, I've seen your child down the road, and you know, and when I stopped to talk to them, they said, yes, sir, no, sir, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am. Well-behaved child. We love to hear things like that. Here, John is telling Gaius, I rejoice greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, to the way that he was living, to the way that he was walking, the way he carried himself in truth. The teaching, that is what we need to examine. The teaching, is the teaching according to the word of God? When we come together to worship God, are we worshiping him, as the Bible states again, John, in spirit and in truth? You are a spirit, and those that worship you must worship you in spirit and in truth. Doing all that the Bible says. If you have no Bible for it, don't do it. Simple as that, isn't it? Yes, just that simple. So if we come together and we think about our worship, let's think about what we are doing. Let's think about what we're doing. And Brother Mark mentioned that as we were partaking of, before we partook of the communion, that we get our minds right, that we focus. Let's remember why we're doing what we're doing. The Bible in the book of Acts chapter 20. Again, we're talking about people worshiping God today. That they come together to assemble together to worship him. That's the first part. You have to assemble together in order to worship God, in order for your worship to be acceptable. So from this end of Broadway to the other end of Broadway, we don't even want to get on the side streets. Just from this end of Broadway to the other end of Broadway, a lot of people have assembled together to worship God. That's a good thing, isn't it? That people have assembled together to worship God. But the question is this: have they assembled together with the mindset of doing what the first century church did? Have they assembled together with that mindset? In Acts chapter 20, verse 7, on the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul talked with them, intending to depart on the next day, and he prolonged his speech until midnight. Now, I told you, we're just going to talk for a little while this morning. We're not going to stay here 12 hours. We're not going to stay here until midnight. But what we have done since we gathered together upon the first day of the week is that we partook of the Lord's Supper. Our example is right here in Acts chapter 20, verse 7. So we want to do the very thing that God is pleased with. That is the reason why Paul stayed back here. In order to meet with the local congregation there and to partake of the Lord's Supper. He could have left the day before, but no, he stayed there, and his intent was to leave the next day. But upon the first day, which is Sunday, they partook of the Lord's Supper. They broke bread. What wasn't a common meal that they were taking here, it was the Lord's Supper. Just as we have done this morning, the unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine. We've gathered together to do that because this is what has been commanded for us to do. Now again, from this end of Broadway to the other end of Broadway, you can go in each one of those assembly places. And how many are partaking of the Lord's Supper upon the first day of the week? Many of them are not doing so. And many of them are not doing so is because they do not believe that God's word has instructed them to do so. They do what they want to do. See, we don't come to worship to do what we want to do. We come together to worship to do what we must do. The things that are pleasing and acceptable in the sight of God, where we can find Bible for the things in which we do. Now, our singing is to edify one another. Our singing is to glorify our God. Our singing needs to be in a manner that is pleasing unto Him. From this end to that end, how many places of worship can you go in? And before you get in, you don't hear the singing, but you hear the playing. I'm not talking about children running around. I'm talking about instruments of music. I was invited to go to a congregation one time, and as I walked up to the building, I heard all this music playing. I was thinking, this can't be the right place. No way. I opened the door and I walk in, and the people, their skin tone is the right skin tone. And let me tell you, I was going to a Hispanic congregation, and the skin tone was the right skin tone. The people looked like the people because I didn't know the people. And I said, this can't be the right place because there's instruments of music. I'm talking about the Lord's church. And I was in the wrong place. And I was so glad I was. I politely turned around and went on down the road a little piece, and I was in the right place. where you did not hear the instruments of music playing, but you were involved in people worshiping God, lifting their voices unto God. According to the book of Ephesians chapter 5 and the verse is 19. Recognizing that which is true. That's what we're talking about. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart. How difficult is that to understand? That when you say that you're doing what God wants you to do, that you can look at the scriptures and say, I am doing it. I'm singing and I'm making melody within my heart, within my mind. I'm making a melody. I understand the importance of opening my mouth and praising God and singing so that the people around me may be edified. May not be a best singer, but that's not what God asked for. In the Old Testament, they had paid singers. They had people that played instruments. We're not paid to sing today. We're commanded to sing today. There are at least about 9 passages of scripture in the New Testament that talks about singing. And not one of them mentions anything about playing an instrument of music. We don't have a piano, we don't have an organ, we don't have a drum set, we don't have bass guitars or lead guitars. We don't have that. Why? Because we do not need that to worship God. Man. We do not need it. We're not instructed to worship God in that manner. But, you know, a man argued me down one day and he said, if I want to play my guitar to God, I can do that. It's not an argument. If that's what you want to do, do it. But it doesn't mean that God is going to accept it because he did not ask for it. You do not give God what he did not ask for. You do what you are commanded to do. And then we think about our giving. Our giving. How are we giving? We give with the purpose of honoring God. Well, we're not trying to outdo anybody in here. We're not trying to give more than Brother Glenn gives. We're not trying to give more than Brother Abernathy gives. We're not trying to outgive anybody. Man. We give as God has allowed us to prosper. And we don't give on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. We give upon the first day of the week. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 1 and 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 1 and 2. Now, concerning the collection for the saints, as I have directed to the churches of Galatia, so you also are to do. On the first day of the week, each of you is to put something aside and store it up as he may prosper, so that there will be no collecting when I come. Upon the first day of the week, it is when we give. You can't give what you don't have. If you have not prospered, you cannot give. We're not talking about going up and storing up anything in a storehouse anywhere. We're talking about as God has allowed us to prosper, to wake up and to go to work to get that check. We give back to him upon the first day of the week. Now you turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. As Paul talks about the collection. Now, I want us to know something, that the collection is not for the world. If the collection is not from the world, we don't ask the world to give in the collection. It's for God's people, and it is given by God's people. that God's people may be taken care of. He says this in 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. You give because you love to give. You give because God has allowed you to get. You know, did that man that always want. He said, you know, the Bible says it's better to give than to receive. Well, what has God given us? What has he given us? And what are we giving back to him? And how are we giving it back to him? If you have that dollar and you're like, man, I really don't want to give this dollar today, don't give it. Don't give it. Because God don't want it.
That's right.
You have to give again with that mindset of a cheerful giver. Loving giving. My cousin, many, many, many years ago, was worshiping in a place, and the man would tell him, you know, God wants you to give your whole check, and then he's going to take care of you. And you know what he did? He gave his whole check. It wasn't that God was taking care of him. He was still staying home with mama, so mama was taking care of him. We need to understand God is not asking for us to give our whole check. But what he is asking is for us to give our all. What does that mean, give our all? You said not our whole check. He wants you to give as he has required of us to give. You give with a cheerful heart, as you have purposed in your heart. As he's allowed you to prosper, you give. But not grudgingly. No one should have to make you give. You know, we our little children growing up, and some still, you know, you give them a dollar to put in, and then when that collection plate comes by, they're like, oh, they want to hold on to it. Now you have to grab their hand and you have to make them put that dollar in there. We're trying to teach them. And some, you don't have to do that. They just want to give. If they got it, they want to give it. And then sometimes you have to say, you put your whole, you put a whole that in there? Then you have to, you know, you have to try, you know, to fix that. You don't go back and you don't ask Brother Tanaka's, hey, my son put all his money in, could you give it back? No, you don't do that. Once it's in the plate, it stays in the plate. Mama, daddy, grandma, grandpa, you have to take care of that. You have to teach them that God is not asking you to give all of your money, but he is asking you to give your all. Then we think about our worship again, realizing, recognizing that which is true. We looked at partaking of the Lord's Supper. We looked at our singing. We looked at our giving. What's left? What's left? That we come together and we pray to our God. We pray to our God on the behalf of others. Those that have lost loved ones. Those that have members that are sick. Those that have strayed away. We pray for them. The work that we're engaged in, we pray for that. Brother Simmons, a couple of Wednesdays ago, he did a lesson on Wednesday night in reference to prayer. Very good lesson, brother. Very good lesson. That was you, right?
Yes, sir.
I figured it was. The importance of praying. The Bible teaches us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that we pray without ceasing. When things are going bad in your life, you pray. When things are going good in your life, you pray. When you're not, listen to this, when you're not in trouble, you pray.
Amen.
Why did I say it like that? Because a lot of times we wait until we get in trouble to call on God. And you know what God is doing? He's ignoring you. Ignoring you. If you repent, then I hear you. But a lot of times we're not praying for repentance. We're asking him to help us. Lord, get me out of this situation that I've gotten myself in. Instead, we should be saying, Lord, forgive me for what I've done. And then he'll hear you. But your mind, your heart must be in the right place. You must be sincere. Man said back in 1990, he said, you're not repenting, you're reporting. You're reporting because you got caught doing what you're doing. Now you want to report instead of repent. See, that's not, that's not prayer. We need to be sincere in our prayer to the Father, through the Son, doing what is right before God. Amen. You go back to Acts chapter 2 and you look when they came together, they prayed together. When Peter was in trouble, the people prayed for him. Paul, being in jail, prayed. What are we doing today? What are we doing today? Are we praying the way God wants us to pray? And then when we pray, we have to understand that when a man is praying for you or for us, that if he's not praying the right thing, we do not amen that prayer. We amen that which is right. We need to continue to look at his word and continue to do the things that we are supposed to do. So there you have what we do when we come together to worship. Four things that we do. You hear the word of God. And that's the fifth thing, being proclaimed unto you. This is what we find in Scripture. Why did Paul stay back again? When you read there in Acts chapter 20, what did he do? They partook of the Lord's Supper. He proclaimed the word of God until midnight. Preaching the word of God is what many people, like to do, what we love to do. This is where we come together to hear the word of God. Now, I've stated this and I'll state it again. You can go home and I can call you up and I can say, what did the preacher preach about today? And some of you are smart and you'll say, you were the preacher, you don't know what you preached about? And what you're doing, you're stalling. You're stalling. Because you do not remember. Don't ask me, because sometimes I don't remember the title, but I do remember the word of God. Amen. And that is what we need to be paying attention to. We're not here to perform. We are here to do what God wants us to do. We are in rehearsal. We're waiting for that great day where we can stand before God and we can be selected because we have done what we were supposed to do in rehearsal.
Amen.
To hear, enter in my good and faithful servant. Not those dreadful words, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Recognizing that which is true. Recognizing that which is true. Sanctify him through that truth. Your word is truth. Do you believe that? Do you believe that there is only one way that God will accept your worship? And that one way is his way. You can't worship the way you want to worship and not have any book kept in verse for it. You can't say, well, that's just what you say. No, that's what God says. Your worship must be in spirit and in if you're here this morning, you're not a child of God. You cannot become one of his children the way you want to become one. You have to become one the way he states in his word. The word that Jesus gave to his disciples. The word that he told them in Matthew chapter 28. Go and make disciples of all nations. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you even unto the end of the world. I'm with you. How to become one of God's children? Hearing his word. In Romans chapter 10, verse 17, hearing his word, which allows you to gain faith. Believing in who Jesus Christ is. Jesus says that in John 8:24, if you don't believe that I'm he, you should die in your sin. If you don't believe, well, what if you do believe? Well, you had an opportunity to live. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Believe in that. Believe in that. Willing to repent. You may have been worshiping God, for 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, and come to find out that your worship was not according to his word, and you're ready to make a change. It's not too late.
Amen.
It's not too late. Put all that behind you. Have a change of mind. Because, when we start talking about sin, a lot of times you want some act that someone is doing that people look at and frown upon. Drinking, smoking, sex, or whatever it is out there, doing drugs. You want to frown upon that? False religion is a sin. Worshiping God in vain is a sin. So why not frown upon that? Have a change of heart. Have a change of mind and say, I don't want to worship that way anymore because there's no Bible for it. And come away from those things. Repentance. Luke chapter 13, verse 3. Do what's right before him. Making that confession that you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Those things are easy, right? You say that I can't worship that way because there's no Bible? Okay. You say that I need to believe in Jesus Christ? Okay. You say that I need to make a confession that he's the Son of God? Okay. You say that I need to hear what the Bible says? I'm willing. Now I'm saved. No, you're not. You're not saved. The Bible teaches in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21, that water that saved those people in the days of Noah. Noah and his family had to get in the ark. They didn't stand back and, ooh, man, we built that. Look at that. Isn't that a nice ark? And it began to rain, and they never entered in. That's not what happened, is it? No, they built the ark, and then they entered into the ark. 8 souls were saved by water. The Bible says in 1 Peter 3:21, the like figure whereunto baptism doth now also save us. Not to put away the filth of the flesh, but to answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Baptism saves. Hearing, believing, repenting, confessing, and being baptized. Repent and be baptized. That's what the scripture sees. Mark chapter 16, verse 16. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Acts 2:38. Repent and be baptized. They go hand in hand. Can't leave it out. You have to do what the scripture says. And after baptism, then what? Live a faithful life. Live a life of truth. Again. 3 John, verse 2. Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you, that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. For I rejoiced greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, as indeed you are walking in truth. So after baptism, walk in truth. Do what is right. Worship according to the pattern. Live your life pleasing to God. Man, some will be pleased and some will not. But it's not about man, is it? It's about God. Do what is right. If you're here and you're not a child of God and you want to become one, there's no time like right now to come to 4, make the confession that you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, have your sins washed away in the water of your baptism, then live a life that is faithful unto Him. Maybe you're here and you're straight away. We're asking you to come back this morning before it is too late. If you confess your faults to Him, the Bible says He's just to forgive you of all unrighteousness. So if you're here and you're subject, we ask you to please come as we stand and sing the invitation hymn.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See, on the portal He's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner. Mercies for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling, oh sinner, come home. Time is now fleeting, the moments are passing, passing for you and for me. Shadows are gathering, death breaths are coming, coming for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh, for the wonderful love He has promised, promised for you and for me. Sin He hath mercy and pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
Page 300.
377. 377.
Beautiful grove so wide, beautiful land of light, beautiful home so bright, where there shall come no night, beautiful brown where shining and bright, oh there, yonder in mansion fair, gather us there. Beautiful road, beautiful land, beautiful home so bright, beautiful bed, beautiful crown, shining so fair. Treasures o'er, where we shall never die, carry me by and by, never to sorrow more, heavenly soul. Beautiful, beautiful groves of white,
beautiful,
beautiful land of light,
beautiful
home so bright,
beautiful
land of mine,
beautiful,
beautiful grounds,
shining,
yes, shining so fair,
beautiful
mansion bright, gather us there,
yes, gather.
Pray. In the name of our Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, let us be thankful for the breath that you first breathed in Adam in the beginning, the rib bone that you took so that we could have companionship, that he have a partner. But pray that we be obedient to your will and not disobedient because of that disobedience. The sin came into the world. Heavenly Father, keep us to remember that that same devil that deceived Eve back then, that caused Adam to be deceived also, is still out here deceiving.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, let us be thankful for the light that you sent down, your Son Jesus, so that we have a will and we have a way, we have a light to walk into if we are living this world into darkness. Heavenly Father, let us be thankful that you have lifted us up this morning with that same breath, with that heartbeat that you breathed in Adam so that we make it to your house of worship. Heavenly Father, let us pray for our elders to keep them strengthened in hopes that we will make it down the path that they have made it to be elders, Heavenly Father.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who have lost someone, but let us remember that, you know, we shall all be transformed one day from the flesh to the spirit, Heavenly Father.
Amen.
The hopes that we will be in your kingdom, Heavenly Father. Let us pray for the sick and shut in, Heavenly Father, and that one day that they may walk back through this door. Until then, let us be thankful that we have the breath to pray for them, Heavenly Father. Let us also be thankful and let us praise your holy name, Heavenly Father, in the blessed Son's name, Jesus. Heavenly Father, and as we walk out this door, Heavenly Father, of your house of worship, let us keep our heads to the sky and always remember that that devil is a liar.
Yes, he is.
That we have the will to walk in truth, and we have the will to come here and worship you each day that we come here, Heavenly Father, as we leave this house of worship today, bring us safely back here on a Wednesday to study your word and to learn your truth and to learn the will that you want done by each and every one of us. So that we will be in obedience and not be disobedient to your will, Heavenly Father. Bless each and every one under the breath of For it's Heavenly Father, in the Son's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.